Good morning. Good morning, it's lovely to see you. And it's lovely to be back here again. You are so welcome today on this fairly cold day. I did a classic British thing this morning. It was sunny, so I left the house thinking it was summer, and I am perishing at the moment. But anyway, that's my own fault. A couple of notices just before we begin. First of all, just to say, I love how you're good Baptists. You all go at the back. No one's coming at the front. First of all, just a couple of notices. First of all, to say that after church, the youth, we got some youth things. So for teenagers, I think Luke and Tim will be doing that. And also we've got a film night, which is on the 9th of March, Saturday 9th of March. And we're going to be watching a film, The Mission, which I've never seen before. You're super welcome to that. It's free, there'll be popcorn, etc., etc. And we will also then do Cafe Church the next day, or Ian will do Cafe Church the next day, based on The Mission in some way. I don't know how he's going to do that. So you'll be so welcome to that, and bring someone along. Okay, it's non-cringe. Just a film, and then Cafe Church the next day. This is a part where people now look at the floor or nudge their partner with a big smirk. Has anybody had a birthday in the last week? Because I know you're not going to do that, so I'm just looking around to see any telltale signs. Has anybody had a birthday? Okay. Let's do a call to worship. We're going to read together. We're going to read Psalm 95, and it's the first three verses. And let me just unpack it just for a second. Ian, you just pop it to the next one for a second, is that okay? So we're going to read the first three verses, but sometimes, if you're anything like me, I read the words, and I don't really think what I'm actually saying until I've read them. So just for a second, have a quick glance before we read them. And I really want to focus on the great King above all gods. Because we're here for many reasons. We're here to encourage each other, to support each other, to show something of what it means to follow Christ. But we're ultimately here to worship God. And that bit, the great King above all gods at the end, I wonder what the small g gods are that you can fall for and I can fall for. Could be the god of money. And it could be the god of comfort, that's a classic one. Could be the god of family, the god of security, popularity. I don't know what your one is which you struggle with. And when we say these words, we're saying on our throne, we're going to put Jesus Christ again. And it's something we have to keep doing day by day, because wrong things go on the throne of our life if we're not careful. Let's read this through together. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and song. For the Lord is a great God, the great King above all gods. Heavenly Father, we come today to worship you and to give thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ. And I pray for each one of us over this next hour, etc., that we will focus on you, Lord Jesus. Help us to put you on the throne of our lives, to take off things which shouldn't be there. Whether we feel it or not, Lord, we give you worship today. And please speak to each one of us, and when we leave this building, may we be closer to the people you want us to be. In your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. Please stand for our first song then. Your name is holy.
mercy for sin, there is safety within. In your name, in your name, there is strength to remain, to stand by the way. In your
seated. Right, the children are going to leave us. Let's pray for them. And am I right in thinking Rachel's leading to? Let's pray for Rachel as well. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for the children at our church here. We're so aware the church is only over one generation from dying. And I pray, Lord, for the children who go out today and for all Rachel has planned, Lord. May there be just something which resonates, something which they can hold and take away and know that they are loved by you, Lord Jesus, and that peace and meaning and joy are theirs through you, Jesus Christ. Amen. Children, escape. And Alicia's going to come up and lead prayers for us.
I'm either going to have to grow or move this, so I'll move this. Can you hear me?
Yes,
sir. Yes, right, okay. I'd like to start our time of prayer this morning with a reading from 1 John 5:14-15. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know he hears us, whatever we ask, we know we have what we've asked of him. As we come here today to worship you, Father God, we thank you for your promise that we can come before you with confidence. We pray for families affected by knife crime, those who mourn for their children who have senselessly died, and we pray as well for those families whose children have killed or injured others, both suffer such loss. We ask that you provide the wisdom and resources to the police, the youth workers, the schools, the churches, people in our society that care to combat this knife culture so children can be safe from such evil. Father, we pray for people we know may be in our own families or friends who have turned away from following you or show no interest in having a relationship with you. This part of our service is not being recorded, so please feel free to pray out loud if you wish to, or silently give those names to God that you wish would form a relationship with Jesus or have turned away from him. Jesus, you told us to be persistent in prayer, so we continue to pray for families who are experiencing the terrible consequences in the war in Ukraine and the Gaza Strip as it continues and continues. I'll just wait and ask if anyone would like to pray, or several of you like to pray for this situation. Father, we pray that the hindrances, the people receiving aid will be removed, and the aid will get to those who desperately need it. And also pray, Lord, for those aggressors who continue to pursue their own agendas. We pray that they would come to look to you, guide and influence those people around the world, our politicians, our leaders around the world, to bring resolutions and to finally bring peace to these areas. Lastly, I thank you for our church family here, which is ever growing, and we praise you for that, and ever seeking your purpose. Strengthen our bonds here as a family so we may continue to love, encourage and build each other up in our faith of our dear Lord Jesus Christ. And in his name I pray. Amen. The next song will be Your Grace is Enough.
Thank you. time to hear God's word for us this morning. This is from Acts chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. Peter heals a lame beggar. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. Now, a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Thanks be to God for this account. James, you want to come up? We're going to pray for you. Thank you. Thank you this morning for James. We thank you, Lord, for all the preparation you've helped him do this week, and we pray now for your blessing on him as he blesses us through sharing what you have put on his heart this morning to say. And we give us ears too to hear what you have to say to us this morning, dear Lord. Amen. Thank you, James.
Good morning. This is my first time using this, so hopefully it will work. So we're continuing with our series on Acts, and we've looked at the first 10 verses in chapter 3. In previous weeks, we've looked at chapters 1 and 2 that cover the ascension of Jesus, the arrival of the Holy Spirit, Peter's awesome sermon, where the church went from 100 or so to a few thousand. And then at the end of chapter 2, a model of the early church, where there was teaching, fellowship, eating, and praying together. And at the end of chapter 2, we're told that the apostles performed many wonders and miraculous signs, but it's in chapter 3 that we get the first described miracle of the apostles. This section is quite a short section. At first glance, we can perhaps skip over. Essentially, it comes down to two men walk into the temple and a man is healed. It's a bit like the start of a joke, really. But this is no joking matter. And on thinking on this section of Acts, we can get a bit more out of it. And it comes down to three themes. Looking out. So that as Christians, we're to look out at the church. And I'll unpack that, and that will be the focus of what I'm going to be looking at. But there's also two other themes that I pulled out of this passage. And the second one is waiting. Things happen in God's timing, and I will unpack that later on. And then the third one is abundance. God gives us what we need, not necessarily what we ask for. Quite often, a group or a club exists for its members. That's not to say that outside issues don't concern them or they engage in charitable acts. But its sole function is for its members. If I join a genealogy club, It'll put on talks for its members about various history or records. It might even transcribe documents for other genealogists. But it's there to focus on its members. It's not out on the street corners evangelising to make new genealogical members, although obviously they would welcome new people in. But if we contrast that to the church has a dual role. The church exists to nurture its members and to support and help non-members. It has a dual focus. This can create tension. Some churches can become just inward-looking, forsaking their role as salt and light in the world. Not following the command of Jesus to go out and make disciples of all nations. Conversely, a church can focus on the outside to the exclusion of its members. And forgetting Jesus' words to Peter in the end of John in chapter 21, where Jesus tells Peter to take care of my sheep, to feed my lambs. But I've chosen the title of this subsection for two meanings. One, as Christians, we look out of the church on the wider world. But we also need to be looking out for opportunities to share what we have, to share the gospel, to share the gifts that God has given us, in this instance, healing. All of us have gifts that we can share, whether it's fellowship, whether it's praying, whether it's just encouraging or being with people. Outward looking is a natural outpouring of the church. As disciples of Christ, Jesus commands us to seek new disciples, to go and spread the gospel. Isaiah 52:7 says, "How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring the good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, and who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, 'Your God reigns.'" And this is echoed in Romans 10, verse 14. "Beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." But equally, we're to show care and compassion to those around us. Jesus says to love our neighbour as ourselves. When asked who our neighbour is, Jesus tells the parable of the Good Samaritan in Luke 10 and describes how we're to care for those outside our family, outside our friends, outside our groups. We're so used to this story that we miss the shock factor that the Samaritans and Jews hated each other. But equally, there's a practical dimension. There's a story from my cousin Sarah, who tragically died at the age of 17. But she was sent out to buy a coat by a mum. And after buying it, she was walking back along the street in Glasgow and saw a homeless man who had no coat, was rather cold. And so she took off her coat and gave it to him and went home. A practical action. Her mother was not so impressed and ordered her to get a new coat. But a love that she had for the people around her just comes through in that story. And Jesus also tells us to pray for our enemies, to pray for those who curse us, to go the extra mile. In Matthew 5:43-48 it says, "You've heard that it was said, 'Love your neighbour and hate your enemy.' But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect." And so we turn to Peter and John. Verse 1 sets the scene. Peter and John were going into the temple at the time of prayer. And as the passage tells us, this was about 3 p.m. There were apparently three specific prayer times, and the 3 p.m. was the middle session. And then we're told in verse 2 that a man crippled from birth was carried to the gate called Beautiful to beg. Now, scholars are not fully agreed on where this gate was. It was either probably Nicanor's gate, which you see in the middle there, or perhaps the gate below that in the eastern wall. But regardless, it was likely a place that was a popular throughfare that had a lot of people going in and out. a place where there'll be more people and people inclined to give him money, as the thought of God is foremost on your mind when you're going into worship. So in verse 3, the beggar sees Peter and John and asks them for money. Was this just a random chance? Although God doesn't tend to do in random chances. Or had he seen them before? Perhaps with Jesus many weeks prior. The text doesn't say. But immediately, Peter and John look at him. The beggar initiates the conversation and they turn to him. Peter and John look straight at the beggar. Do we look at people? Do we look straight at people who we might find uncomfortable or perhaps beneath our notice? As a scientist, I've worked with some quite important scientists and lowly technicians. And I've done lowly technician work myself. And despite the lowly work being quite essential foundational work, the high scientists tend to dismiss the technicians as worthless. Or perhaps when you're in the street and a big issue seller speaks to you, do you walk on past him, pretending you haven't heard or mumble something about no change? Or do you stop and engage them as another human being, someone made in the image of God? Peter and John were ready to respond. They were looking at him. And they looked at the beggar. They were treating him as a human. But Peter doesn't just look at the man. He wants his full attention. And so he tells the man, "Look at us." You can imagine the scene. The beggar asks for money, and the disciples say, "Look at us." So the man is looking at them expectantly. They must be going to give him something, which in the context with the man, he must be thinking that it's a little bit of money, perhaps a bit more than normal because he's been responded to. Then in verse 6, Peter says, "Silver or gold I do not have." In other words, they're saying, "We don't have any money." And in that instant, you can almost hear the cogs in the man's mind being disappointed. Why does he want me to look at them? But Peter straightaway continues, "But what I have, I give you. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, walk." Peter then helps him up, and the man is healed in that instant. The man jumps up and begins to walk. More than that, he immediately goes into the temple's courts, walking and jumping. The sense of joy just leaps out and he praises God. Healed by Peter in the name of Jesus, he immediately jumps around and praises God. This jumping and praising of God harks back to the time of David when the ark was brought into Jerusalem, when he leaped and danced before the Lord, which you can read in 2 Samuel chapter 6. Peter had looked at the beggar, engaged with him, then ministered to him. The man may not have been a member of the church, but he was not ignored. Peter and John are showing an out of focus, and this theme crops up numerous times in Acts, such as when Peter goes to the Roman centurion in chapter 10 and stays under the roof and shares a meal with a non-Gentile, which is a non-Jew, quite a shocking thing at that time for Jews to do. Peter and John respond to the man. They healed him openly and publicly and healed him in the name of Jesus. And we have to remember that just a few weeks prior to this, the authorities in the temple had condemned Jesus and had him crucified. And here is Peter standing in a very public place, healing in the name of Jesus. A contrast from when he denied Jesus and hid in the room with the disciples at their lowest point. But here Peter is a greatly transformed man, from a man afraid to a man confident in Jesus. And there will be consequences to this action. But he wants to serve God. He isn't constrained by the feelings of others. Do we live out a Christian life fearful of what others say? Do we hide the fact? Or do we proclaim our faith? So the next theme is waiting. Everything happens according to God's timing. God is in total control. Romans 8:28 says, "And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. Now the beggar, we are told, is a cripple from birth in verse 2. Yet if we read a bit further in chapter 4 of Acts, verse 22, it tells us this man was over 40 years old. So he had lived as a cripple for over 40 years. This situation mirrors the healing of the blind man. Jesus had left the temple in John chapter 8, and walking along in John chapter 9, he saw a blind man. And verse 2 picks up the story, where the disciples come to him and say, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus responds, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned, but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him." It's such a short verse and very easily skipped over. But if we actually stop and think, this can be quite a tough verse. The blind man had been blind all his life so that God's work could be displayed now. He'd suffered a long time. In the same way, the cripple had been suffering his whole life, more than 40 years. That is a long time in society where physical health was key. It begs the question, why wasn't he healed by Jesus sooner? Did the cripple just not coincide his begging time when Jesus came or went from the temple? Did his friends who drop him off at the gate just not bother taking him to Jesus? If this was so, it would contrast with the friends of the paralytic man in Mark 2, verses 3 to 5. Some men came bringing to him, Jesus, a paralyzed man carried by four of them. Since they could not get to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and then lowered the mat the man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Jesus saw the faith of the friends of the paralytic and said to the paralytic, "Son, you are forgiven," and healed him. Are we the sort of friends who would bring others to Jesus, or more like the cripple's friends and not bother? Bringing friends to Jesus is one of the callings of a follower of Jesus. Andrew, who we don't really hear much about in the Bible, was the one who brought Peter to Jesus, and we know how important Peter was. But we could be giving the cripple's friends a bad rap. Perhaps they just didn't know. Perhaps they did leave him in the pathway of Jesus. Perhaps Jesus walked past him, but just like the blind man, it wasn't the time for healing, and he had to wait until the right time for God's work to be displayed. The Bible is very big on waiting. When Jacob saw Rachel, he immediately fell in love with her, but he was willing to wait 7 years working before he got the chance to marry her. When Moses was born, the man who God would use to lead his people out of slavery from Egypt, there were two periods of 40 years. 40 years as a prince of Egypt and 40 years living in Midian. And when David was promised that there would be a descendant of his who would sit on his throne, 1,000 years elapsed between David and David's descendant, Jesus. Now, it's a hard fact of life that people here in the world suffer. Mental health issues, disabilities, addictions, living under cruel regimes. These can go on and on for years with no apparent end. Some people get healed, some people get saved, some people don't. If we recall that the Jews in Egypt were in slavery for hundreds of years before they were freed, generations were born and died before they were led out of slavery. In the book of Job, this theme is taken up. Job is afflicted. God permits this, but it's also clear that God is in control. He sets the limitations that cannot be crossed. And Job's friends come to him and say, "Well, obviously, Job, you've sinned, because otherwise, why are you suffering? But Job refutes this narrative. He says, "I've not done anything wrong." He wants to ask God, probably demand answers for why God is allowing this. And at the end of Job, we have a conversation between Job and God. And God comes to Job and says, okay, Job, I will tell you your answers if you answer my questions first. And God proceeds to ask questions that Job cannot hope to answer. And in the end, Job recognizes that God is in control. He is just a man. He acknowledges that this is God's world. And God accepts his humility. But Job then needs to go and offer sacrifices against the sins of his friends who had essentially badmouthed God by saying, look, Job, you've done wrong. It's easy to fall into easy answers. Perhaps, oh, you can't be healed because your faith isn't great enough. And it's easy to demand instant results, to expect instant results. That's how the world works today. Instant, instant, instant. But God doesn't work that way. God works patiently and in his timing. He's working all things out according to his will and for his glory. Ultimately, the end is described at the end of Revelation, where God will dwell with us, where there will be no mourning or weeping, where God will wipe every tear from every eye. But until then, we live in a fallen world. But this man, despite 40 years, was eventually addressed by God, and God's power was powerfully displayed. Don't give up hope. God does work. The final theme, abundance. God offers more than we can ask. This man was just asking for some money. He's begging at the beautiful gate. He's asking for money, just a bit, so that he can perhaps buy some food, maybe have a roof over his head for the night. But that's just one day. Tomorrow, he'll be back needing more. Yet the apostles didn't give him money. Instead, they offered him so much more, something that he actually needed, but was probably gone past thinking because he'd just spent 40 years in his condition. So used to his life and position, he was only focused on the small, the here and now. But the disciples healed this man in the name of Jesus, and he was healed. God gave this man way more than he asked or even expected. Do we suffer the same issues? Have we lost sight of God? Sometimes in the here and now we can lose sight of God, asking for small things instead of the powerful, life-changing things. And when this man was healed, he immediately praised God. In verse 10, the people in the temple said, recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Peter and John, they stop at the gate. Peter heals the man. He doesn't do it secretly. He doesn't say to the man, oh, meet me around the back of the temple in 10 minutes for a secret healing. He heals him there and then in broad daylight. Following Jesus is about being in the light, being open. We are called to be salt and light in the world. Matthew 5:13-16 says, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. We don't hide who we are. Instead, we're open about it. The man's natural response was to praise God, and the wonder and amazement caused the people to come and see across the temple, and Peter had the opportunity to speak about Jesus again. And although reading into the next chapter we see Peter and John are imprisoned for this event, yet about 5,000 people come to faith, possibly even doubling the number of believers in one single event. If we were to sum up, the church is to be outward focused, not to the exclusion of its members, but focused on those outside, ministering to them. We are called to be open and visible. Peter was open and healed in the authority of Jesus. We need to wait on God's timing. This can mean many, many years. But God offers an abundance. God gives generously. After all, God has given his only Son that we might go free. When added to the number who became followers of Jesus in chapter 2, the number in the temple, we can see that Jesus' words in Matthew chapter 4:19, when he said to them, "Follow me and I will make you fishers of men," have come to pass. In the week ahead, will we keep our faith to ourselves, or will we look out? Will we be caring and ministering to those around us, open to any opportunity God may provide? After all, as Paul wrote to Timothy, God didn't give us a cowardly spirit, but a spirit of power, love, and good judgment. Amen. We'll stand for our next song, What a Beautiful Name.
Yeah.
standing, that'd be great. Let us pray if I do a blessing. Lord Jesus, we are so grateful for James and for all the time and effort he's put in that talk, Lord. And I pray for each one of us now, each one of us here who's a Christ follower, may we share the good news of you, Jesus. Give us opportunities this week which we take with our actions, with our words, but may we always do it with love and humility and grace. Teach us, Lord, how we can share the good news of you, Jesus, to the society we find ourselves in. Amen. That's a blessing. A blessing is from Colossians. It says, Paul says, let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen. And I'm very aware that we've got a few newbies today. You are so, so welcome. Please come through, have a coffee and a biscuit. And if you are a regular here, seek out the people who are new. And God bless you this coming week.
The grace of God has reached for me.